Hey everybody, what's going on? I am Greg Sussman, joined once again by Jim Sonnis of FanDuel. What's happening, Jim?
It's all good, Greg. I had a lot of fun with the NFL draft this weekend. A lot of interesting landing spots to discuss. So the draft hyped a lot, but lived up to it. So I was pretty satisfied. How are you doing?
I'm doing great, man. It was really fun to just sit back, watch some football stuff for, you know, a little while anyway, and kind of take our minds off of things, which is great. And now our minds are still on the NFL where they should be. Let's go over some of the winners and losers from draft weekend, because now all seven rounds are in the books and we have a good idea of who's come out on top. So let's begin with the winners today, Jim. And we begin in Denver, where just about a year ago, this team looked boring. It looked gross. It looked like a team that was going to be in the doldrums of the AFC West for a while. It's amazing what a year will do when Cortland Sutton steps up and when you draft players like Drew Lock and Jerry Jeudy. Things are looking a whole lot better in Denver.
Yeah, there is nothing boring about Drew Lock in general. He's kind of a weird dude, but in a fun way, because he can be a little bit erratic, but that's not always a bad thing. It can be fun to watch. And now what we have here at Drew Lock is a really good situation. When you look back at last year, his number three, you know, pass catcher on that offense when Lock took over was Tim Patrick, a guy who was undrafted. And now instead of that, he is throwing to Cortland Sutton, Noah Fant, Jerry Jeudy, and KJ Hamler. And what Jeudy and Hamler provide is a lot of speed in that offense. Noah Fant has that as well, but this is going to be a fast team. You can throw out Albert O in there as well, a later round pick reuniting with Drew Lock as they were teammates at Mizzou. This is going to be a pretty fun and pretty fast offense. And what that does is it dramatically shifts the expectations for Drew Lock. Whereas before, you could have had some reservations because he's a second-round pick, and second-round picks don't normally pan out as quarterbacks in the NFL. He also, in that limited sample as they started last year, faced a lot of really bad defenses. So the numbers behind what Drew Lock did were a little bit tainted by the teams that he faced. But now he's got three legitimately good receivers, a great tight end, and they also added some depth along the offensive line on day two and day three of the draft. So I think if we're talking about situation for Drew Lock, whereas it wasn't that good at the end of last year, it now looks really good heading into 2020. And situation matters so much for quarterbacks. We've seen this before with guys like Jared Goff in the past, what a situation can do for a quarterback's outlook. We can still have questions about Drew Lock's talent, but what we can't question is the fact that his odds of succeeding just increased this weekend with the additions they made to this offense. So I think we can still, you know, have some minor trepidations about Drew Lock because, again, second-round picks don't pan out all that often, but he has the tools he needs to succeed. And if he was capable of succeeding, we're going to see that this year. So Drew Lock is someone I think we can invest in best ball leagues because there's no legitimate backup behind him. And I think for Dynasty as well, the odds he pans out just went up. That makes him a big winner from this draft weekend.
Drew Lock's a huge winner from draft weekend, but I want to throw this back at you. Given what they did in the draft with Jerry Jeudy, with some of these other wide receivers here, is Cortland Sutton a loser?
I wouldn't say a loser, because I think with KJ Hamler, it's not a guy you'd expect to get a ton of usage. Jerry Jeudy will, but we've seen a lot of offenses that can support multiple fantasy relevant pieces as long as the quarterback plays efficient enough. And I think that's the question here with Drew Lock. But I think the thing with Cortland Sutton is he has their rapport with Drew Lock already, and they will have this weird offseason where they're not going to have a lot of time to develop guys like Jeudy and Hamler. That should give him a leg up. But also, Cortland Sutton is pretty freaking good. When you're that good, it's hard to take away usage. So I wouldn't say Cortland Sutton is necessarily a winner in the situation, but I also wouldn't downgrade him all that much, despite the fact that there are viable alternatives in this offense now, whereas there may not have been previously.
Just remember, before Pat Shurmur was the Giants head coach, he was the offensive coordinator for the Minnesota Vikings. And they certainly had a couple of wide receivers in Stephon Diggs and Adam Thielen that worked out well with a quarterback like Case Keenum. Well, hopefully Drew Lock's better than Case Keenum, and we'll see if Jerry Jeudy and Cortland Sutton can become the next Adam Thielen and Stephon Diggs. Things looking up for Drew Lock and the Denver Broncos. The Indianapolis Colts, well, they made a whole lot happen over the draft weekend. We'll begin with what they did at running back with Jonathan Taylor, who stepped in alongside Marlon Mack in that backfield. People are saying, hey, Jonathan Taylor, he may be the starter from day one. You think he's a big winner? after round two.
Yeah, I think when you look at Jonathan Taylor, there were a couple of questions you hypothetically could have had around him coming out of Wisconsin. One of them was that, hey, you know, he's at Wisconsin. They're a traditional powerhouse with this tremendous offensive line, a very creative run-blocking scheme. That could lead to potential busts in the NFL. You could question the pass catching and if it was legitimate or if it was just forced to him, and questions about the fumbles. One of those questions just went away because he goes to from one of the best offensive lines in college to arguably the best offensive line in the entire NFL with the Indianapolis Colts. So he's still going to be running behind a great offensive line. That is no longer a concern with Jonathan Taylor. I also think that the pass catching could stick around here because Frank Reich is a really smart offensive coach. And he knows how to get his playmakers the ball in good situations. And I think that bodes well for Taylor still getting passing down work in the NFL. Phillip Rivers has always been a guy who's been very willing to throw to his running backs, partly because Anthony Lynn wanted him to do so. But I also think Rivers, at his advanced age, could be someone more willing to give those touches to Jonathan Taylor. So I don't really see any reason to be super worried about Jonathan Taylor now, whereas I had some concerns with him initially coming out. This landing spot is tremendous. The rushing efficiency is going to be outstanding for a guy this fast behind this offensive line. There's always a possibility he becomes a legitimate threat in the passing game as well. So I think this kind of wound up being the best case scenario for Jonathan Taylor outside of being the Clyde Edwards-Helaire pick at 32nd overall to the Chiefs. This is kind of the number two best situation you could have had. I think that when you trade up and invest as much in Jonathan Taylor as the Colts did in this draft, it says that they want to give him the ball early and often. And that to me says he needs to move up on our boards relative to where he was coming in.
Jonathan Taylor in prime position coming out of the draft to be a major fantasy factor here in his rookie year. But just like I did about Cortland Sutton, I have to ask you about Marlon Mack. A good year last year, made fantasy owners a lot of money. Worried about him next year?
Big time. Yeah, absolutely. Because again, like, you don't trade up for Jonathan Taylor in the second round if you feel really good about Marlon Mack. Marlon Mack has had injuries. His snap rate was pretty funky after he came back from those injuries too. So I think that, you know, I have Marlon Mack in Dynasty. I probably should have been more heads up to the fact that they could have been adding to the running back room. So mea culpa on that one. And I think that it's pretty much shot for Marlon Mack because Jonathan Taylor is really good. And if he gets that job, I don't see him giving it up.
This is going to be a tough year for all rookies, which may hurt a player like Jonathan Taylor, but he's certainly NFL ready, running behind that awesome offensive line at Wisconsin. A RBU of sorts, Jonathan Taylor, ready for day one, we hope. One more running back we want to get to, and that's in Tampa Bay, where we've talked about Free Rojo for a really, really long time. I think we may have reached the end, thanks to Keyshawn Vaughn.
Yeah, Bruce Arians was not one of the guys in the Free Rojo trade. He did pretty much everything he could to keep that in a cage, and now I think that ship has sailed because Keyshawn Vaughn kind of got the best case scenario here. And the big thing that I think helps vault Keyshawn Vaughn's value is that Bruce Arians has talked a lot about trying to find a guy who can be on the field for all three downs, where you don't need to telegraph what you're going to do. We don't want, it sounds like he doesn't want like a Sony Michel, James White scenario where you know what the team is doing based on the personnel. It sounds like he wants someone who can work either as a rusher or a pass catcher. And Keyshawn Vaughn showed in college he is capable of doing both those things. He had 28 receptions for 270 yards this past year. He also had a 74th percentile speed score at the combine, according to Player Profiler. And now he gets to play in an offense that's going to score points. There are not a lot of holes in this Tampa Bay offense after they added Tristan Wirfs at right tackle. I think that this is all really good for Keyshawn Vaughn. We can expect him to be at least, at a bare minimum, the passing down back in this offense, but I also think there is the potential for him to be a borderline workhorse, given what Bruce Arians has said about how he wants to use his running backs. If you get a workhorse in an offense that has guys like Mike Evans, Chris Godwin, and Tom Brady, it's probably going to lead to a lot of touchdown potential. So I think that Keyshawn Vaughn, although there is still the risk of Ronald Jones lingering there and taking away some touches, I think that it's going to be Keyshawn Vaughn who gets the money touches, specifically in the passing game. And that's what we want here. So Keyshawn Vaughn, I think the landing spot is perfect, and we should react by viewing him a lot better than we would normally view a running back who goes in the third round.
Bruce Arians is old school, man. Like, he wants his quarterback, his wide receivers, his tight end, and his running back. They didn't want anybody to come off the field. He's not all about these rotations and a goal line back and a third down back. He doesn't care about any of that crap. He wants his guy on there 100% of the time. And that's not Rojo. It's not Peyton Barber. It's going to be Keyshawn Vaughn. in a great spot. And maybe, you know, if not the first pick because of what Kansas City did, but the second pick in a rookie draft this season. I said there's one more running back, but now there's really one more running back. Let's get to Cam Akers with the Los Angeles Rams. We did a video a week or two ago about Malcolm Brown and how you and I were just incensed that this guy was going in the late 100s or like 160s or something like that, and how he's going to be the starting running back for the Rams, and people are idiots. You know who the idiots are, Jim? That would be you and I, because Malcolm Brown's not going to start for this team. It's going to be Cam Akers.
Yeah, it's like the opening scene of The Hangover, where we're on the phone and we say, we messed up. We should not have said to invest in Malcolm Brown, because the line of thinking here was that the Rams didn't have a lot of picks, and it was hard to see them investing one of those picks on a running back. But now with the information we have to react to that. And they used their first pick in the 2020 draft on a running back. And I think this is kind of a sneaky good landing spot for Cam Akers. So while I was into Darrell Henderson and Malcolm Brown before, I'm very okay changing my tune and buying into Cam Akers now, because this Rams offense improved as the season went along last year, specifically from week 11 on. They changed up their scheme. They kind of changed the way they were running the football, and they changed their personnel along the offensive line. And from week 11 on, they had a 45.4% rushing success rate out of their running backs. That was up about 2 percentage points from previously and a good chunk above the NFL average. And Todd Gurley actually, I think, was a top three guy in success rate for the full season, despite the fact that he didn't look all that good when running the football. Sean McVay is still a good offensive mind and knows how to scheme a good ground attack. So Cam Akers, if he can get that top job, should be put in a pretty good position to succeed. And I don't think getting that top job will be all that difficult, because again, the Rams spent their first pick in this 2020 draft on a running back for a reason. That means that they are not like us. They didn't have a ton of faith in Malcolm Brown and Darrell Henderson. I think they're going to give this job to Cam Akers. I think this offense is in line to rebound next year. Not only did they get better as the year went along, but they also get guys like Brian Allen back healthy once again. So there's going to be a lot of competition on the interior of that offensive line. So if one guy's not good, they can always try someone else out. That's not a bad thing to have a lot of competing pieces up front. So I think the outlook here is pretty good for Cam Akers and potentially for the Rams in general, given the fact they did make those scheme changes last year and do have some interesting weapons on offense now once again as well. So Cam Akers, I think he has a good shot to nail down that early down and potentially workhorse role for the Rams. And if he does, I think it could be arrows up for sure, because this team, a little bit underrated as we progress through this offseason.
The only thing that I disagreed with there is that the Rams are a sneaky good landing spot for Cam Akers. I don't think it's sneaky, Jim. I think it's a clear great landing spot for Cam Akers, who, with the Rams investing an early round pick, not just an early round pick, their first pick, as you mentioned a couple of times there, in a running back, they're going to hand him the rock. And I think it doesn't say anything good for Darrell Henderson, who was inactive a few times last year. It doesn't say anything good about Malcolm Brown. This offense produced Todd Gurley, and I'm not saying that they made Todd Gurley, but Sean McVay didn't just lose his brilliance after one Super Bowl appearance. Sean McVay is someone that wants to run the football. When they changed their offense and focused on the tight ends and ran it a little bit after week 11, it was the running game that really was the main benefactor here. I really, really like Cam Akers a lot going into 2020. Let's go back to the Indianapolis Colts here, and let's talk about the wide receiver they traded up for, and that is Michael Pittman. He was a player that many believe could have been a first-round pick, son of a former NFL player. Pittman has the ability to step in and be a major weapon for Phillip Rivers right away with Indianapolis. You saw, other than T.Y. Hilton when he was injured last year, they didn't have much of anything. You know, Devin Funchess, he was kind of a disaster. Ryan Grant, also a bit of a disaster. Chester Rogers. I mean, this team didn't have enough talent catching the football. You had a player like Michael Pittman, well, that changes very, very quickly.
Yeah, Michael Pittman checks a couple of the boxes again that we talked about before, where he was the first pick that a team made in this draft as he was taken 34th overall by the Colts. And he also goes into a situation where he should be able to get usage right away. Like you said, there's not a whole lot behind T.Y. Hilton on this depth chart. It's guys like Paris Campbell, who missed a lot of the time last year due to injury, and Zach Pascal, who was fine, but he's not necessarily someone you want to build around. Not a lot of draft stock put into Zach Pascal. I think we could see a situation where Michael Pittman Jr. is starting pretty much right away. He had a 93rd percentile speed score according to Player Profiler and a really big body, which makes him a good complement to T.Y. Hilton, which is what you would, I would assume, want if you're Frank Reich. Get guys who complement your number one wide receiver, and Michael Pittman does that pretty well. Phillip Rivers gets a bad rap because he throws a lot of picks, and he's not quite Jameis Winston, but, you know, he was a guy who did take chances last year, which led to those picks, but it also can lead to upside for wide receivers. He had a really high deep rate, an above average deep rate last year with the Chargers. So although Rivers may not be as efficient as he once was, he's not a guy who is afraid to go deep. He does check it off to running backs, but he also throws it down the field. It's kind of a weird paradigm to have in this, but it certainly is something that you look at the data. It says that Rivers does both those things, and Pittman goes to a team with a great offensive line. We talk a lot about that when it comes to running backs. But what that does is it increases the odds a team gets to the red zone and can produce touchdowns. Where would you expect Michael Pittman to win? In the red zone, producing those touchdowns. So it's an early opportunity. It's a good team with a solid quarterback, and they invested a high-end pick in him. I think that Pittman has a chance to make a difference right away, and he's someone who has both short and long-term appeal for dynasty leagues.
At least in the near term, I think what's really great about Michael Pittman is that the quarterback is Phillip Rivers, who doesn't have any allegiances to any players, even the marginal players like a Zach Pascal, who was solid last year, but there's no allegiance there. By Phillip Rivers. Yes, T.Y. Hilton's very, very talented, but everybody else, it's kind of up for grabs. And I think Michael Pittman has a chance to make his mark right away. Same with Jonathan Taylor, as we spoke about a little bit earlier. The Colts are going to have a brand new look and a positive one, I think, from a fantasy football perspective. One more player to get to, Jim, and it's for your New York Jets. The Jets and Joe Douglas worked the board up and down over the weekend, and eventually, it seems like in the second round, they got the guy they always wanted, which was Denzel Mims, out of Baylor. How good can he be as he seemingly immediately becomes the number one wide receiver and the number one target for Sam Darnold?
Yeah, we had talked about this Jets team previously, going into the draft, about how their number one need from a need perspective was offensive line, because the depth chart there was so terrible. But the only reason that was even a discussion was because of how bad their depth chart was at wide receiver. Jameson Crowder is fine, but after that, it's Breshad Perriman, who is on a one-year deal worth just $6 million, not a ton of investment there, and Quincy Enunwa, who has had a lot of neck issues and may not even be able to play in 2020. What that means is that Denzel Mims is going to step in right away and, like Michael Pittman Jr., have the chance to start from day one with this offense. And I think he can climb over those guys like Perriman and Quincy Enunwa in a hurry. Not Jameson Crowder. I think that he'll still be a big fixture in this offense, but he's a speedy guy who can get downfield, and I think that's really intriguing. We also have a good thing here at the Jets that we alluded to at the Colts, where the offensive line is not a plus for the Jets, but it's a whole lot better now than it was at the end of the last year. It's not just Mekhi Becton, it's Connor McGovern, Greg Van Roten. They've made a lot of changes along this line, which means we can expect the team overall to be more efficient. That generates more touchdown chances and leads to additional upside for players within this offense. Sam Darnold should have more time to throw. He can be more efficient. He can generate more touchdown drives, and that's all good for guys like Denzel Mims. He got a good landing spot. He had good athleticism, good production at Baylor. He checks a lot of boxes, I think, can contribute right away. So it's a bit concerning that Mims did fall to 59th overall and the Jets traded down rather than drafting him at 48. Those are slight concerns, but Mims still has a lot to offer. So I think if you're looking at day one contributors, Mims' landing spot was tremendous. And if he has a talent, which he seemed to have at Baylor, it could lead to long-term success as well.
The success was clear at Baylor for Denzel Mims. And you mentioned Breshad Perriman here with the New York Jets. You mentioned Jameson Crowder. Denzel Mims does something that, well, those guys, they don't really do. He is an athletic freak. And we'll see how that translates with Sam Darnold, giving him a big target that he so desperately needed as he makes progress in his development under Coach Adam Gase. That's going to do it for us here on the FanDuel Hurry Up. Jim, we talked about a lot of winners today. Unfortunately, it's losers tomorrow.
Yeah, can't be too optimistic for too long, Greg. Got to rain on the parade at some points. So we'll talk about players with their stock trending down after the draft tomorrow and round things out here. But I think overall it was a pretty optimistic weekend for the draft and a lot of rookies winding up in really good landing spots.
I'm just excited to talk more about Aaron Rodgers and Jordan Love. For Jim Zonis, I am Greg Sussman. Thanks so much for joining us. We hope you enjoyed and come back tomorrow as we talk about the players whose stock are down after the NFL draft. Have a great night. Stay safe, everybody.